Our next we're going to have a set of three speakers, and they're going to talk about a novel program that they've developed for working with persons with dementia that has applicability to caregivers as well. First is going to be Jean McGranahan. She's the founder of the Mindful Movement for Alzheimer's, that in the program MM4ALLZ. That's what the shortened version. Jean is an experienced registered yoga teacher and yoga therapist candidate. She specializes in working with adults with dementia and cognitive impairments. Her interest in this work was sparked several years ago when she worked as a nursing assistant in a memory care facility. But before that, she discovered the healing power of yoga and has continued to study yoga, movement, and breathing techniques and their relation to brain neuroplasticity. So Jean currently teaches yoga and mindful movement classes at several community centers and assisted living facilities. She leads weekly, assisted living, right? The second speaker is going to be Margie. Okay, got it. Margie Young. Margie Young has been teaching yoga full-time since 2001, shortly after getting a master's degree in choreography and dance from the Tisch School of Arts at New York University. She leads weekly classes, teacher trainings, and retreats in the Bay Area and internationally. Margie holds a 500 status yoga with Yoga Alliance, as well as certifications in restorative yoga, prenatal yoga, pelvic floor yoga, and craniosacral therapy. She was recently named one of 100 most influential yoga teachers in America. Margie is especially interested in this work as she lost her father to Alzheimer's disease several years ago. And then our third member of this group is Dr. Baxter Bell. He is a physician, medical acupuncturist, yoga instructor, and writer. He is co-author of the book Yoga for Healthy Aging and co-creator and contributing writer for the blog of the same name. These explore the benefits of yoga in the context of aging. Dr. Bell is a certified yoga therapist himself and serves on the board of the International Association of Yoga Therapy. His background in Western medicine informs his therapeutic approach to teaching yoga students, training yoga teachers and therapists in the US and abroad. So please welcome our group to learn about mindful yoga.
Thank you, Dolores. Good afternoon, everyone. I want to thank you for sticking around right now. I know you have continuing education credits waiting, but thank you very much. It's been an honor to be asked to speak here today. Would you all close your eyes, and we're going to do three deep Himsa breaths. I want you to inhale through the nose and exhale for the mouth. And do it with me. Here we go. Himsa. 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 That's a Himsa. I want to take just one moment. I really loved what Dr. Gross had to say today. We are not really going into detail about this today with our program, but grief and giving the okay to grieve, and I mean, every day, you know, we face it. And part of our program, because you're coming from a yoga world, you're coming in, you're teaching, as you face this every day. So thank you so much for that. I mean, it was just really great presentation. We would like to thank all of you in the audience for your compassion and commitment for making the lives better for individuals and their families with dementia. So from the three of us, a thank you today, everybody out there. It's been a great honor and privilege that I've gotten to work with people over the last 5 years, incredible people, amazing people. They happen to have dementia. And I have old-fashioned note cards, too, I'll say. So what is Mindful Movement for Alzheimer's, and how did it get started? I started teaching people what is yoga 5 years ago. And I found there was really no protocol, there were no industry standards to work with individuals with Alzheimer's and dementia. And so I asked the advice of a woman I considered was just the expert in the field. And I will never forget the words she said to me. When the session ended, she said, you know, there's really not much you can do. She said, just have them take a couple deep breaths and raise and lower their arms a few times. Promise. And I walked out of there and I said, you know what? That's not acceptable. I'm not going to accept that. And so, and so that kind of became the catalyst for our entire program. And what we did is we started teaching people and we started observing what worked, what didn't work, and we started learning from our students. And one of our big focus was to affect the neuroplasticity going on in the brain. So our students actually developed some of these patterns. We then started looking at research, and we refined our techniques to include some evidence-based techniques. And you'll get an opportunity to see some of this in action today. So I'm curious, how many of you have done yoga before? Yeah, what do you think? 70%? Okay, I want you to forget everything you ever thought you knew about yoga. Because, you know, and I'm kind of conscious using the name mindful now, by the way. But mindful movement for Alzheimer's is very different than a mainstream yoga class. One other catalyst for me is many years ago, I took a yoga class at a studio. And I was a student. And this stunning woman came in, young woman. And her caregiver came in shortly thereafter. I wouldn't have known that she had dementia had her caregiver not come into the room with her. And you could see people starting to stare at them. I felt bad. And you could see the awkwardness. You could see how uncomfortable they were. I think they stayed 5 minutes, and then they exited the room, and I never saw them again. So there is such a great need in our communities for programs like Mindful Movement. And the need is twofold. It's not only for the individuals to have a place to come together, but it's also a need to train people with specific techniques to work with these individuals. And we hope our program fills the gap there. So what are the benefits of mindful movement? We have on the slide the benefits are for the body, the mind, and emotions. And I would like to cross out the word emotion and say it's for the human spirit. We had the word sangha up on the screen. The word sangha is coming together. It's a group that comes together. The person is no longer the person with dementia, but they are in a group with other people. They relate. There's a lot of studies that have been done, just that sense of community. So that is one of our key concepts in our program. The other thing is we've seen a greater sense of balance, improved strength, and an improvement in cognitive function. I'm going to turn it over to Margie at this point.
So thank you, Jean. I'm going to go a little bit more into the techniques and things that we do in the classroom, and then the best part of this is I'm going to get you moving, too. That's the best, if you ask me, to get everybody moving in the room. As Dolores, when she introduced me, she said my father died of Alzheimer's about 5 years ago, and I moved from New York to San Francisco to help with the caregiving. And towards the end of his life, I would go in, and he would be very, you know, slumped over, eyes closed. It would take me a little time to get his attention, and I would remind him who I was, and I would say my name, and then usually a little perk would come, and then I would tell, he loved his dog. I would say, do you remember Matador? We used to throw balls for him, and do you remember when he could get like four balls in his mouth, and he would get a little brighter? And then, you know, I'd mention something about his business, which he spent his whole life doing, and eventually, if I reminded him of enough things, he would very much like come to life, almost look like he looked when he was healthy. His chest would lift, his eyes would twinkle again. In our classes, this reminiscence therapy is a crucial part of what we do. From the very moment that people walk into the room, we know their names as best we can, and then as we get to know people, we get to know where they're from or what they did, so that we have a connection. When people walk in the room, we address them by name. Hey, Joe, I remember that you're from Cincinnati. And usually just something like that really begins the process of the body awakening and the mind also awakening. Jean talked about the importance of the group, the sangha, coming together. There's been so many studies about loneliness, depression, anxiety, and the importance of a group. And we often see the students very much feeling a surreal lightness in being a part of the mindful movement group. I'm just going to mention about neuroplasticity, as Jean said, and we have a movie, a little video to show you, and Baxter talks more about the neuroplasticity piece, but I just wanted to mention it here because shortly when we do get moving, you will have an experience of your right and your left hemispheres of your brain working, and perhaps you will even feel new neuro pathways open. Okay, hang on, we're on the wrong slide. There we go. There we go, the techniques. All right, and the last thing that I'd like to say is whether you run a facility or a doctor, nurse, physical therapy, spouse, child, anybody in the caregiving community, just the fact that when you offer this material that we're creating, you also do the movements with whoever, the individual that you're with, and there's great benefit to anybody who moves and breathes and brings their attention inwards. So the benefit of the caregiver and the individual, it's just coming together in this new way, can be a great thing. Okay, I know that a couple times in the last short amount of time we've taken a few breaths, but I think you can never do that quite enough times. So if you could just scooch a little bit forward on your chair and root your feet onto the ground, and then I'm going to step to the side and get the this mic on? Hello? Testing? Nope. Hello? On. If you could just take your right hand and lift your right leg, and we're going to count to five and tap the right leg five times. One, two, three, four, five. I didn't hear you. We'll do the second side. We're going to count backwards, five to one. We do a lot of counting forward and backwards and in different languages as a way of alerting the mind. One, two, three, five. Sorry, here we go. We're going to go backwards, which starts with a five. I got it now. Five, Dolores is on me. Four, three, two, one. Okay, let your hands rest onto your legs. Close your eyes. And do three breaths, breathing in through the nose, and then letting a sigh, like, on the exhalation. So we'll do it together. Take a deep inhale. Exhale, one. Inhale. Exhale, two. Inhale. And then let your eyes open. Look around, see who's sitting next to you, and just do a, just if you don't know them, make sure that you know their names. That's part of the sangha, the community, and you might be running into each other. So if you run into somebody sitting next to you, I just want to make sure that you at least know their name. Let's interlace the fingers. We're going to do a few little exercises to work with the range of motion in our joints. So just let your wrists roll around, and you can't do this wrong.
So you're just exploring the movement of the fingers and the wrists and the hands. Good. And then go in the opposite direction. Good. And then, like you're playing the piano, just wiggle your fingers, take your arms up. Oh, look how pretty that is. And then bring your arms down. It brings me back to my old modern dance days. Bring your fingers up. And then bring your fingers down. And then we'll do what we call this Tai Chi wrists, the wrists just moving from side to side. Good. And then let your hands come back down. And we'll just tilt the head over to one side. And then bring the head up and tilt the head over to the other side. And bring your head up. Turn your head, and you might see that person that you just introduced yourself to, and then turn your head over to the other side. One more time, turn the head to one side, and then turn your head over to the other side. Good. And then come back to the center. Okay. So we do our classes seated in a circle, but I'm going to have you stand up because I know it's a long day in a convention center. So we're going to stand up and we're going to start working doing the piece of this that is about the neuroplasticity. I'm going to teach you a little pattern with your legs. We'll just take, you can take, let's take the right leg. Let's count in Spanish up to five, tapping the right leg. Uno, dos, tres, cuatro, cinco. Oh. Let's do up to 10 on the other side. Seis, siete, ocho, nueve, 10. Okay. So let's take the right leg. If you do your left, it's fine. Again, you just can't get this wrong. And what we're going to do, it's about the trying. It's not about the achieving. It's about the trying that opens the pathways in the mind. We're going to take the right foot and tap it forward, side, forward, together. That's it. Forward. Side, forward, together. Say it with me. Forward, side, forward, together. A couple more times. Forward, side, forward, together. Forward, side, forward. Perfect. Other leg. Forward, side, forward, together. Forward, side, do it a couple more times, and as you're doing it, you can say it or not, and see if you can just get it into your system, get it into your muscle memories. Okay, good. Ready for the arms? We're just going to do the arms and then put them together. Da-da-da. Okay, so the arms go like this. Clap, back, up, down, out, down. That's the pattern. Clap, back, up, down, out, down. Clap, back. Say it with me. Clap, back, up, down, out, down. Two more times. Clap, back, up, down, out, down. Okay. We're going to put it together. Do you have to get it right? No. I'm testing. That's a test. You don't have to get it right. It's about the process. Okay? Let's remember how the leg goes first, and then after a few cycles, we'll add the arms. Leg, front, side, front, together. Front, side, front, together. Front, side, we'll add the arms. Front, clap, back, up, down, out, down. Clap, back. Don't watch me. I'm very likely to screw up. Clap, back, up, down, out, down. Clap, back, up, down, out, down. Okay. So, Jean taught me that sequence, and when she first did it, I thought, no way, I can't do it. I can't do it. And I've been practicing it for months, and I still kind of can't do it, but I'm getting much better. And this, as you'll see in our documentary, that she's going to show a short documentary soon, you'll see that people learn these patterns. People with dementia learn these patterns, and they learn them so well that then we have to shift and do a different pattern. Okay, I'm going to pass this on to Dr. Baxter Bell. Thank you very much.
All right, can everyone hear me okay? It's my superpower. I can speak through walls. It's great to be here. I've also been teaching yoga for quite a long time. I was a family physician full-time for about 11 years out of residency. And during that stressful period of my life, I did my first practice at home to a Rodney Yee video. Rodney's from Oakland, California. I was living in the Cincinnati area, and it changed everything. And a couple years later, I was having a conversation at a cocktail party. Someone said, "What are you thinking about doing next year?" And I said, "Oh, I was thinking about taking a sabbatical and moving to California to study yoga and acupuncture." And sure enough, that's what happened. You got to be careful what you say out loud at cocktail parties. So I'm just going to share with you a little bit of information. Because of my background in the medical realm, and as you've experienced today also, we have a lot of data that comes from research. And especially when we're talking about these complementary therapies, it seems to be helpful to have some indication that these therapies have some sort of documented and documentable benefit for people. So I'm just going to mention two studies, although there are a few others that look at yoga for those with dementia and Alzheimer's disease and also with mild cognitive impairment. But know that just like the slide we saw in two presentations ago with that exponential rise in research that's happening generally with mindfulness practices, the same thing is happening with the yoga practices as well. So as a member of the International Association of Yoga Therapy, we sponsor a scientific conference every year. And this year we have so many submissions that we're thinking about maybe splitting into two conferences or maybe actually publishing our journal more frequently because of the rise in interest in this area. So I'll mention that there was, this isn't the right slide, is it? Let's see. There was a study done just this last year at UCLA that was looking at the possibility of reducing cognitive impairment by using yoga techniques. And what they did in this study, it wasn't a very large study, and this is very typical of most of these yoga studies because they're not necessarily getting lots of funding, so they have to start with smaller groups of people, but they split the groups into the gold standard, which was the memory enhancement practices, and they compared that to a group doing yoga practices. And what they found was that both styles of practice improved memory, but the yoga practices went beyond that. They saw improvements in mood, lessening of anxiety, a decrease in some of the cognitive and behavioral challenges that often accompany dementia. And they also did functional MRI studies at the beginning and at the end of the study, and only in the yoga group did they see actual functional changes on the MRIs that was considered significant. So we see some equivalency in some areas, but some additional benefits that seem to come from utilizing yoga as a tool for this particular group of people. The other study that I wanted to mention briefly was the fact that yoga practices are known for the rest of the population who don't have this particular condition to be quite helpful in maintaining and improving overall physical strength and physical ability. In fact, in my book, Yoga for Healthy Aging, we have a whole section on how yoga is such a great practice for strength maintenance. As we get older, there's something called skeletal muscle atrophy that affects almost everyone. It's actually considered a normal part of the aging process. And yet we actually know that if we establish and maintain some of these yogic-like practices, we can forestall that process from getting into the sarcopenia level in which things become much more significant for people's everyday lives. So there was a study done in 2014 by a group of four researchers. They were looking at whether or not the yoga practices could improve physical skills in adults who had moderate to severe Alzheimer's in a nursing home setting. And in fact, the study was able to show that it had a significant improvement in that area. So my hope is that this trend with research looking at yoga as a tool for this very important population continues. I know that's going to be happening, and that we'll see even more and more benefits over time with studies like these two and others that are starting just at this time. And in fact, our group had the great honor of being invited down to USC earlier this year, where we got to share our training program with a group of individuals that were both professional caregivers and also community caregivers. And so we're starting to share this on a more formal basis. It was a half-day seminar, so several hours were spent. We got into some of the other techniques that are used in a typical protocol session with adults that have MCI and early stage Alzheimer's, and we're looking to have more collaborations with that group and others as time goes on. I just wanted to mention again that in the world of yoga, things keep evolving just like they do in the area of research and treatment for dementia and Alzheimer's, and over the last 20 years we founded an organization of professionals that offer yoga therapy, which is kind of an advanced level of yoga training. A typical yoga teacher gets about 200 to 500 hours of training. Yoga therapists get an additional 800 hours of training. And our organization, IYT, accredits institutions that train yoga therapists now, and now we credential those that have graduated. So if you see someone with the initial C-I-A-Y-T after their name, it means that they're actually a credentialed yoga therapist. So that's exciting, and as I mentioned, we're also sponsoring research and giving a forum and a platform to those that are doing it. From our group standpoint, we're actually in the very early stages of conversations. In fact, we had a lovely conversation just a day or so ago on over Zoom, in which we're going to start to gather data from the classes that we're starting in Northern California. We hope to have a formal research study going within the next year, God willing, and all the hoops that one has to jump through to get that happening. And so we're very excited about those collaborations. And we hope to come back maybe another time and share with you what we've discovered from the formal research that we're going to try and do in the near future. So I think with that, I'm going to give the microphone back over to Jean, who's going to give you just a couple of final thoughts, and then we'd like to share our video with you if we have time for that. So Jean, you want to come up? Thanks, everybody.
Fast forwarded. By the way, I think you all did great on the neuroplasticity sequence. So as Baxter mentioned, we've been very lucky to be rolling out our program. We rolled a program out at the Bay Area Community Respite Daycare. It was an 8-week program, and it was the purpose was twofold. One, to train the staff there, which included administrators, a yoga teacher, believe it or not, an activity director. We also had 25 individuals with different stages of dementia that came for an 8-week session. We're starting in June to work with the Northern California early stage program coordinator. We're going to be rolling out a program in 8-week sessions for a year. And then we're also working with a community, the Rutlinger, in May, where we're going to be rolling out a program for a year. I want to tell just one more quick story. I'm known for my stories. At Bay Area Community Services, we talk a lot about reminiscence therapy. And we started out, you know, we ask everyone, where are you from, your name, something about them. If they can't say the name, you know, they have a name tag. So the very last session, there was a woman, she did not say a word for 7 weeks. And the last week we went around the circle, and somehow I skipped over her. And she said, wait a minute. You forgot to ask me my name and where I'm from. I was flabbergasted that she's speaking. My name is Judy. I'm from Texarkana, Texas. I had to look that up, by the way. But right then I knew exactly why we were doing what we're doing. And anyway, I can't wait for you to see the documentary. So if you're interested in the training, we have two options. One option is we will come to you and we will do group training. You can email us at info@mindfulmovementforallz.com. Another option that we are rolling out this summer is our online training. Am I really loud right now? Is it blaring? Yeah. Okay. So the online training is coming. Stay tuned for it. And that's online modules. And we'd love to tell you what we do. So I hope you enjoy the documentary. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Dr. Baxter Bell, and I'm one of the founding members of Mindful Movement for Alzheimer's. And I'm going to speak with you for a moment about this fascinating capacity of the human brain, the human mind, to change over time. The technical term for this is neuroplasticity. It turns out that from the time we're born all the way through our last day on the planet, if we're relatively healthy, the mind has this ability to continue changing and morphing and adjusting to the circumstances that we encounter in our lives. Of course, when we're a child or an infant, that change is happening very rapidly as the brain matures and grows. But it turns out that even as adults, this ability for the brain to change still takes place. And what's interesting for the group of folks that we're interested in addressing, those people with Alzheimer's and dementia, is that even in mild cognitive impairment stages and early stages of Alzheimer's, it's been shown that this ability to rewire, this neuroplasticity, is still operating. Neuroplasticity usually takes place because of certain stimulation to the brain. So for instance, our behaviors, if we're learning some new movement pattern, is one way that can happen. The environment that we're in can sometimes stimulate the brain to change as well. Emotions can have an impact. Our thoughts themselves, the way we're thinking and the way we're using our brain, can also impact the brain. The brain can actually grow new neurons, the actual nerve fibers that transmit information around the brain itself, and new synapses or connections between the neurons can also form. Exercise has been shown to be one of the easiest ways to stimulate neuroplasticity. In the Mindful Movement for Alzheimer's program and sequences that we offer to our students, we utilize these realities to stimulate neuroplasticity. We use yoga postures, we combine movement and breath, we allow our students to experience using the right and left side of the body at the same time in different patterns that are quite stimulating and engaging. And so through a combination of use of language, even having them play around with remembering how to count in different languages, and also by asking them to remember things about themselves, their full name and where they were born and maybe where they went to school, using something called reminiscence therapy, we combine this, all these different facets, into a unique program that is Mindful Movement for Alzheimer's and takes advantage of the brain's ability to be involved in neuroplasticity to keep us cognitively alert and healthy over time. I hope you enjoy watching Jean as she shares some of these techniques with her own students using the Mindful Movement for Alzheimer's techniques.
Hello, my name is Jean McGranahan, and I'm one of the co-founders of Mindful Movement for Alzheimer's. It's a yoga-inspired curriculum that is focusing on cognitive improvement. I have had the honor of my class joining me today to show you some of the work we're doing and some of the various movements of neuroplasticity. You'll see some of these movements are not easy. This is a great group of individuals. It's an honor to teach them, and I learn every day. They become the teacher and I become the student. Our program is different than traditional yoga in that it's not just doing yoga poses. It's not just doing breath work. But our goal is to engage both the right side and the left side of the brain. And we have tailored our program and the movements to do just that. And when you're using both sides of the brain, you're firing up the neurons, neuroplasticity is happening. You're basically rewiring the brain. My students actually sometimes come up with different patterns. And as you will see, you know, the leg's going one way, the arms are going another way. The other key component is that everybody's welcome. It doesn't matter if you can do the physical things, because even saying the movements out loud, even if your leg can't move, but you're saying it, you're still engaging the mind. And the third really key concept of our movement for Alzheimer's is the coming together as a group, because you're no longer just an individual person, but you're a person in this group, in this circle, which is why we do it in the circle. And people seem to come awake.
My name is Ophelia Alieto, and I was born in Havana, Cuba.
Love it.
Cuba.
Havana, Cuba. Yeah. Alan, please. Born.
Alan. I was born in Omaha and raised in Los Angeles in New York.
We do some controlled breathing where I count the breath. There's no stress on anyone. So if they can't do it and they want to sit there and just do breathing on their own, that's fine too. But we do breathe throughout. We take breathing breaks throughout where, you know, we might call out, let's do some lion's breath. They love the breathing part. I love the breathing part. It just seems to kind of focus everyone and calm everyone down. So that's a very important piece of the mindful movement program. Take a deep lion's breath for me. Ready? Inhale. Ah. Two more times, deep inhale. Ah. Let's take the arms up for 10 together, and let's count French for the heck of it. Here we go. Ready? Reach them up there. Keep going. Inhale. Cat. You got it. Sink. Come back to center. Tap the right leg. And let's take the leg up. Let's add the arms too. If you can't do both, don't worry about it. We're going to do it. Let's count together. Here we go. Let's do Spanish. Here we go. Uno. Dos. You got it. Tres. Good job. Cuatro. Looks good. Cinco. So I'm going to go really slow. Here we go. Clap. Back. Clap. Back. Up and down and out and down. Clap. Back. Clap. Back. Up. Down, out, down. Get ready to add the arms. Clap, back, clap, back. Up, down, out, down. Clap, back, clap, back. Up and down and out and down. Clap, back. I can't look at you. Up and down, I'll mess up. Last one. Clap, back, clap, back. Up, down, out. Another very important aspect of the program, besides the neuroplasticity sequence, and we call that the mental fluidity sequence, is the balancing sequence. Because as people age, or even if they are not an older individual, but if they have a cognitive impairment, balance is a big deal. If someone falls and someone gets hurt, you know, that can really set a person back. So we work a lot on balance. But not just typical balance, we're still trying to engage the brain in the balancing. Right arm out to the side, right foot up if you can, airplane arms. Lose the balance in the chair. This is called control without a balance. I love it. Arms come up, bend that right knee, let's go. 10, you got it. 9, beautiful. 8, keep going. 7.
That's good.
Thank you, my friend.
We love your class.
Oh, thank you. See you guys next time.
We'll do.
One for the road.
One for path.
A caramel. You know what? Okay, caramel is going to be that one, I think. If I'm a caramel girl, so I'm guessing it. You see,
I couldn't tell, but
it's got the swirls on top, usually.